me start by apologizing for the delay. There was a bit of a communication breakdown between us and our service providers, so we started a bit late. My talk is freelance, remote working, or both. Before I go into my talk, maybe let me give a bit of a background about myself. My name is Anna Makarudze. My first degree is in computer science. I graduated 2009, and I've worked for several organizations. I've worked in the telecommunications sector. I've also worked for a university. Then I also went into consultants in 2013. When I was working on a project in Mozambique, but the company that employed me was a local company. So we had like projects in several countries in Africa. So you will have two projects, one which you are a resident consultant, and then the other one which you work from remotely. We were doing mainly, it was more of business analysis, systems analysis, and design, helping our clients through the implementation processes of our telecommunication systems. So the remote working that we did then, you work with a team maybe that is in Namibia or in Zimbabwe, while you are in Mozambique or Malawi. So you communicate via email and via Skype. But today I will talk about a different way of remote. You'd wonder why I'm talking about remote working. So, the aims of my presentation today is to help us help each other by presenting possible employment opportunities, given that which come through freelance work or doing remote working or combining both. Then I'll explain how you go about doing freelance or how you go about doing remote working, and then the benefits of each. Then the reason why I'm doing this. Let me move the mic. Okay, the first one is currently, we all know that Zimbabwe is over 90% unemployment rate. It's difficult to get a job locally in Zimbabwe, whether you are a developer or you are not. So instead of crying that there are no opportunities, the internet has turned the world into a global village. You can communicate with people all over the world. You can make friends. You can work with people who are not within your geographical location. So instead of crying foul that there are no employment opportunities in Zimbabwe, we could be working towards creating employment opportunities for yourself or for others around you by probably working on your skills, so that you could probably doing either freelance or you can do remote working. Then the other thing is, since we are here at a PyCon, the conference is about Python and related packages. You find that the reason why we had trouble getting sponsorship here in Zimbabwe is we don't have many organizations which are using Python in Zimbabwe. So if you are a Python developer, you could have the skills of Python programming, but where do you get a job? If companies are only starting to use Python now. I know of Econet, which is trying to start to use Python for data science. But if you are using Python for other purposes like data science, it means you have the skills, but you have nowhere to apply them. So you could consider freelance, or you could consider remote working. Then the other thing is, it's a fact, if you Google Python jobs everywhere else but in Zimbabwe, you find there are lots of opportunities. You go on, I could give you a list of websites which will give you that they are looking for Python developers. I've been to PyCon Namibia, and one of the organizers, Daniele Procida, who's also a Django Software Foundation co-member, He's also a co-developer for Django CMS. He said the reason why Django CMS would fund a conference in Namibia or anywhere else in the world for Python and Django is because they use conferences as recruitment opportunities. When we went to PyCon ZA, most of the presenters would give either a talk to do with their companies or to do maybe a lightning talk or a talk. But after presenting the systems that they offer, they would have a slide which they would say, we are recruiting, come and talk to us. We had the sponsors take a lot, Oracle, what, when they gave you the gifts, they would give you Amazon Web Services, they would give you that they are recruiting. I went to Amsterdam early this month, and the brochures that we, the company gives you a company profile, and they're always saying, we are looking for talented programmers every time. So you find we are here in Zimbabwe, and there is no company that is recruiting. Because probably there's so far there's not a company that is doing we don't have a company that is doing Python programming. So everywhere else there are opportunities for programmers, especially Python programmers. So they just because there are no opportunities in Zimbabwe, that it doesn't mean that it is an end of the road for us. You can be looking for opportunities elsewhere. So because every other country is looking for Python developers, I think we can see that we are actually in high demand. It's only that we are not working on our skills and we are not marketing our skills if you have them. So there's a reason for us to consider either doing freelance or doing remote working. So why would you consider freelance or remote working? Because if you are doing freelance and you are based here in Zimbabwe, maybe you do a project for a company in Europe, the money is paid to you in Zimbabwe. So also the country's economy improves. It's also true if you are doing remote working for a company whilst you are here, you get your salary and then when you pay your taxes, Zimbabwe gets some revenue and our country, you know, benefits from that. So it's a good option to consider doing freelance or remote working before you consider relocation. So what is a freelance? A freelancer is someone who's self-employed and you are not necessarily committed to a particular employer long term. What it means is, suppose Petrus is something that he wants to be done, I can do for him for that project, and then when the project is over, he pays me the money, then I'm free, it's got something that he wants done, I can do the project for him, and he pays me, then I move on. Or I could be working on a couple of projects, if I can manage, I work on a couple of projects at the same time, and then I'll be getting money from both clients. So you are not employed by one employer at the same at any given time. You just have clients who contract you short term. So how do you get jobs as a freelancer? You have to look for the jobs yourself. You can do that online or you can do that offline. Online, you Google, you can subscribe through freelancer websites, which I'll mention later. Then offline, you can be talking to people doing marketing yourself. Then you can also get jobs through referrals. What would you require to be a freelancer? You need to have some basic project planning and management because you are basically doing everything yourself. You can't afford to pay other people to manage the project for you. So you basically need to work on your project management skills. You also require problem-solving skills. What I mean is software programming is you are developing solutions to address a need. So when your client has a need, you need to be able to think outside the box to give them a solution that will work for them and to give them the best solution. And you need to be able to give alternatives. If they don't like your first alternative, first choice, you give them maybe two or three choices of solutions, then they choose what they think is best or what they can afford. So you actually need to have problem-solving skills to be able to address needs your clients have. You also need to have presentation skills. Like I said, you are going to be proposing solutions to customers. You need to be able to present them to your customers. You need to be able to convince a customer that this is the right way to go, and you need to be able to give them the advantages, the disadvantages. You need to be able to sell your idea to your customer. So that requires presentation skills, because you are a freelancer, you are doing everything yourself. You don't have the marketing person to do your marketing, and you doing the technical thing. So you need to have like all the skills combined in one. So you need to have presentation skills to be able to sell your ideas to your customers. Then you also need to have report writing skills. When you do a job for a customer, they need to get reports, especially if the project is going to run for like 6 months or a year. You can't just be working on the project, whether you're at the customer side or you're working from home, and you don't even get any updates how far you've gone. So every now and then you need to give a periodic updates in the form of reports. So you need to build on report writing and make sure that every now and then you give your customer reports on progress. If you face any challenges, those should be mentioned in the reports that you'll be giving your customer. You also need to have documentation skills. One thing that I don't like as a programmer is documentation, but you have to do it, because you can't produce a software for someone and then you don't give them documentation on how they can use it, or if they need to make changes, how they go about it. And there are certain things that they don't have to contact you for support, which they can do themselves if you give them documentation. Documentation is also necessary because it will help you even when you want to train your customers. You need something to refer to, so you need to be able to document each and every step of your system. And this also includes your code. Your customer should be able to see all the documentation of their code if they require. So even if another programmer is to take over from you, they can be able to follow to see this function while solving this problem, instead of just writing a list of functions which no one can follow what they do. So you need to be able to document your projects. Then you also need to be able to train people. You need training skills. You develop a software package that needs to be used by users who may not be as computer literate as you are, and you may not be as tech-savvy as you are. So you need to be able to produce training manuals which can be followed step by step by people who are not tech-savvy, so that when you produce software for your customers, you can be able to train them and they will actually use it. Because you can produce something that might never be used because people didn't get enough training to understand how to use the system. Because what you need to realize is when you implement a new system, change is always difficult for people. People resist change. And they might think at first the system is complicating their lives, or maybe there are some loopholes they were exploiting during the time they didn't have that system. So you need to be able to train people so that at least they can use your system. And if you need to train a support person, you need to train him so that if he needs to support the system, they can do that without you. Remember, you are going to be working on multiple projects, so you don't want to lock your customers to you for support. If they want you to support them, it's fine, but you don't want to end up at a point where you have to support 20 customers and you can't afford to pay people, or you don't want to pay people to do the support work for you. So if you need to be able, you don't want to make the system rely on you, so that if I travel, I'm away for 1 week and my customer's system goes down, there's nobody to take off. So you need to be prepared to allow some other people to support your system. Don't make yourself like so important, indispensable, because you don't tell your people, the people who are supposed to use your system, how it works. So you need to be able to train your customers. Then since you'll be running a business, you generally need some bookkeeping skills, because you need to be able to manage your finances to make sure that you can go through the month. You can't tell your customer, you get a new customer, you can't tell them that you don't have transport to come for a meeting. It's not their fault. You're supposed to manage your finances and make sure that you can continue acquiring more customers, or you can support the ones that they have, the ones you already have, without asking them to say, come and get me here. If they are going to pay for your transport when you give them a job card, it's fine. But you can't tell them, I don't have money to get into town to come and fix your problem. So you need to be able to manage your books. Then you also need to know, beyond programming, you need to know Git and any other collaboration technologies like Slack, IRC, or because the thing is that is happening is you are working on your own, so you are relying on, if you face a challenge, you are relying on support from the community. You have no one to ask to say, help me with this code. So if you are going to be getting support from the community, the Python community, you need to be able to have knowledge of online technologies. How to, if I want somebody to work on my project, which is on GitHub, how do I give them permission to do that? If I want someone to look at my code, we are chatting maybe on IRC or on Slack, how do I copy that code and send it to them so that they can look at it? Because you have nobody else to look for to help you with your programming issues, so you are going to be relying more on the community to help you when you have challenges. So you need to be able to collaborate with others online. Then you require time management skills. You need to arrive for meetings on time. You need to be able to deliver your projects on time. Then you require also discipline, even when no one is watching, because you are your own boss. Most of the people are used to working under supervision. So if the boss is away, I can be on Facebook, I can live streaming videos when I'm supposed to be working. But if you don't deliver, you don't get paid. It's different from when you are working for a company like Zesa. You can decide not to do your job. At the end of the month, you can just claim your salary. But if you don't work as a freelancer, you don't get any money. So you need to be able to be disciplined even when no one is watching. I have a project that has to be delivered by the 5th, and you have to deliver it by the 5th so that you can get paid. So what is remote working? Remote working is a situation where you are working for a company that is not necessarily within your geographical location. So you are working for a company that is maybe in another town or in another city or another country or another continent. So remote working also can be considered as working in a environment which is not your employer's. So you can be working from home and not working from the office. They also consider it as remote working. But the kind of remote working that I'm talking about is you're working for a company that is not necessarily within your geographical location. So what do you require for you to be able to do remote working? You need experience in freelance, because when you are applying for a job that is where they want a remote worker, they need evidence that you can be able to work under minimum or no supervision. Because they are in Australia, they need to know that you are adhering to your working hours, you deliver when required to do so. So how do we get started? The first thing that we can do to be able to be a remote developer or a freelance, you obviously need programming skills. It could be Python, maybe a few other Python libraries, or maybe you're not a Python programmer, you work with other languages, but you need to have programming skills. You also need to know how to integrate with databases, because you realize most of the projects that we do, they somehow rely on the database. So you need to be able to work with a number of database packages, because probably you are familiar to MySQL, but the company that you are doing the project, they are telling you are already on Postgres and they don't want to move to MySQL. So you need to be able to work with a number of database packages depending on your customer's needs. Then you also need an office or somewhere to work from. It can be from home, you can rent some office space, or you just need somewhere where you can work from, where you have power, where you have got internet. So you need an office. You also require your own hardware. You can't tell a customer who wants something from you that I don't have the computer to use. What are you doing as a developer? You need to at least have a development machine that you can use to do your programming. Then you require a reliable internet connectivity. Because remember, you are working with people who are not necessarily within the same office building with you. So it, you might need to communicate with them. And the cheapest way to communicate with people is via internet, because you can just, there are several ways of chatting. So you need a live internet connectivity, and you need to do research. So you need to have internet so that whenever you face a problem, you can be either searching for help, or you can be asking for help from friends. Then you need a website or a personal company. If people are going to hire you and they are not within the same geographical place with you, they need to confirm that this person actually exists and is authentic, that he or she is a developer. So you can say, I'm a developer, I develop using Python and Django, I develop websites, but you don't have a personal website or even a blog. They need to authenticate you, so you need to have either a personal website or a company website. You also need a GitHub account or a Bitbucket or similar. I normally use GitHub. If you listened to Mike's presentation yesterday, he says when he's recruiting, he looks at what somebody has contributed. So if you have a GitHub account, they can be able to look at your projects, the projects that you have done that are listed there on in your repository. They can also see the projects that you have contributed to at the open source projects. So they can actually say, okay, this is really a developer. You also need a LinkedIn profile, because you are saying you're a developer, you're a professional. So if I'm going to be vetting you, I need to find consistency between your personal website, your LinkedIn, and your GitHub account. Because I need to, I'm vetting you online. You are not where I am. So I need to at least be sure that this person is authentic, that they are a developer, and they can do what they say they want to do for me. Then you also need a Stack Overflow account. This shows that you, at least you are programming, either you have, you may not have answered questions on Stack Overflow or asked questions on Stack Overflow, but you are showing that at least you are within the developer community, you are working, doing something. And when recruiters are looking for programmers, they usually ask for all these accounts. So you need to have at least, you have to have these accounts. There are many other websites that you can join, but at least make sure that you have Stack Overflow, you have Git, and you have a LinkedIn profile. So where do we get these opportunities? There's a website called Tunda. This one is meant to help Africans who need to get into freelance working, because there's been a reputation that when we get projects, we kind of under-deliver. So they help you get projects, they manage them, and then when your project has been accepted, you share some bit of revenue with them. They take a percentage from the money that you would have made. Then Upwork is another freelance job website that you can, it also works the same way. So you can actually Google for jobs for that are related to your field. Freelancer is another website that you can visit for job opportunities. You can always Google them later. Then there's another one called Django Gigs. It's also another website that you can consider if you are looking for jobs as a freelancer. Then there is People Per Hour. There is another freelance website that you can visit. Then there is guru.com. It's another freelancer website that you can visit. Then there is Django Jobs. Django Jobs, certainly it features both freelance jobs. It features freelance jobs, it features remote jobs, it also features even full-time jobs. So those are sites that you can consider visiting for opportunities. Then if you are looking for remote jobs, the Python Software Foundation, their official website, the Python website, there's a job section. You can get various kinds of jobs that you are looking for. Then Stack Overflow. also post jobs. Hackering again, Stack Overflow and hackering and many other sites, they are sort of like sort of a networking, a social site for programmers. So you can, for hackering, they give you code challenges, you solve them. And then if you earn a certain reputation, they help you find a job. Then hackering, Stack Overflow, you can get support for your programming issues or offer other support, but they also post jobs on their website. Code Hire also, remote jobs if you are considering them. Then LinkedIn also has got a section for jobs which you can consider visiting. Then djangojobs.net, I had already spoken about them. Then there is OfferZen. This company made them in South Africa. They also place Python programmers, so you can consider visiting their website. Then there is hired.com. It's another placement website which you can consider visiting. Then there is Indeed website. It's another website that you can visit. So, you have been working as a programmer, how do you build your profile? You need to list your work experience. It might not necessarily be in Python, but you need to list working experience that is related to software development that you have. And this includes even projects that you have done during your attachment while you were in college. You need to list that as well. Then you also need to list the skills that you have, especially if you are looking for Python jobs. There are so many Python libraries. So normally they specify the ones that they are looking. If they are looking for a back-end developer, they specify a front-end or a full-stack. A full-stack is somebody who can do both front-end, back-end, and also can implement the database. So you need to be able to list all the skills that you have on your profile. This could be on LinkedIn, this could be on djangojobs.net or on hired.com, whatever site you have visited. You need to be able to create a profile that will help you get jobs. You also need to be able to list projects that you have done. And this is where your GitHub comes in handy. You are saying you have developed this website and it's online. They need to be able to go and check your repository for that. So you need to be able to list projects that you have worked on. That shows your clients that you can do what you are proposing to do for them. You have experience in doing development. Then you also need, again, to list your GitHub account or a Bitbucket. You need to list your Stack Overflow or a LinkedIn account during your application process. So you need to have created this account, because when you want to use any site for looking for development work, they ask these profiles as prerequisites for you to create your profile. Then the personal website. Then after building your profile, now you use your profile on the placement website that you have registered on to apply for jobs. Other companies may also require you to apply by email or via their own company website. So you need to be able to, you can just prepare a profile that you use, and then if you are required to apply probably through the company website, you are now just doing a copy and paste. So you need to be able to list all the projects that you have worked on, the skills that you have, and then you just have them handy so that when you are looking for opportunities, you just use them, because this is something that you are going to be doing frequently. And then a cover letter may be needed sometimes, so you need to have all that in hand, and then you need to make sure that your cover letter addresses what the recruiter is looking for, or what your client is looking for. You can't use a standard cover letter throughout, so you need to adjust that letter to meet the requirements of your client or of the recruiting company. Then when you are interviewing about the programmer's job, the thing that happens is the first stage after you submit your resume, the first thing that they do is they give you a technical interview. So they give you a list of questions, programming questions that you have to solve. So you, they give you, they ask you to work on them and submit the answers. So you need to be able to be to respond to that technical interview. So you need to be able to respond to the technical programming questions to demonstrate your capabilities. And you only proceed to the next stage of the interview process after passing the technical interview. So I have gone through this process and failed one technical interview this month. So one warning that I'll give you is, please research more on the company before the technical interview, because the company will give you problems that are related to the nature of their work. So if you don't know how important the questions you have been given are to you, you can take them lightly and then you fail the technical interview. And once you fail the technical interview, they don't proceed to the next stage. So when you are working, you have managed to secure the freelance job or the remote working job, what you need to do is you need to be professional always. You need to work like you have a boss, even though you are your own boss. So if you are supposed to produce a report, make sure you produce it, and you produce it on time. If you are saying I work 8 hours a day, you need to make sure you work those 8 hours a day. If you are going to spread them during the course of the day, it's up to you. But you need to make sure that you need to be professional always, and you need to behave as what a bigger company would have done if they got that project. So you need to be very professional with your clients or with your employer who has employed you. Then you need to meet deadlines. Always be time conscious. Your client is working with a deadline. Probably they are waiting for you to complete that project for them to launch a product. So you can't afford to delay the project because you are delaying your client launching. And by delaying your client their launch, it means you are costing them money. So you need to be very time conscious and always make sure you meet all the deadlines that you are required to meet. Then you need to communicate with your clients or employer regularly. Because remember, you are not working from their office. So it's not like you are going to bump into them in the corridor to say, I'm working on it, I've just incurred on this delay. It means that you need to make an effort to just say, okay, I'm now at this stage. Communicate regularly, even if you face any challenges. You need to give updates to your customer or to your employer frequently and continuously, regularly. You need to make sure that they have correct updates of the status of the project at any given time. Then when necessary, you need to advise on best practices. Remember, as a freelancer, you are more of doing everything, even consultants and the like. So you cannot do something that is wrong because your client insisted on that. You can actually give your client a disclaimer that I am only proceeding with this because you have insisted on me implementing this way. Otherwise, the best way would have been to do this. And when you give them a disclaimer and ask them to sign for it, when they encounter problems later, they will not blame you. So you need to make sure that you advise on best practices, and if your client chooses otherwise, you ask them to sign a disclaimer so that the project failure is not blamed on you. It's blamed on the client's decisions. But they have to make informed decisions because you have advised them well. So what are the merits of freelance? The first thing is flexibility. You determine your working hours. I like working through the night. So if I'm working as a freelancer now, so it means that I can decide to pull an all-nighter and then sleep during the day. It's entirely up to me. I can also change my working hours to fit maybe my schedule. If I have other programs that I want to do during the day, I can work through the night, or I can, during the morning, I attend meetings, I attend other things, then I continue during the night. So you are flexible as a freelance. Then the other fun part of it is you draw up your own job description. So instead of being given a fixed job description, you can do what you enjoy and you work on what you like. And then when you don't have projects, you can always travel. I've been enjoying traveling this year, so you can always enjoy that. Then the demerits is it may be difficult to get projects on your own. And then getting help with code, you have to rely on the community. Then merits for remote working is there's no need for relocation. So you can do your programming thing and continue to be in the society that you are used to. You can attend your friends' birthday parties and the like. You are still in town. You don't have to worry about relocation. Then, like I said before, your host country's economy benefits from the taxes that you from the income that you make. Then demerits is it removes the human touch that is experienced between co-workers. If you work together, you develop friendship, you feel for each other, especially when somebody is going through a rough patch. But when you work from remotely, you don't know each other. Unless you meet a conference, you can be working for years with somebody whom you have never met. So it's not that personal. Then getting help from colleagues on your projects may be complicated, especially if your time zones are different. Because right now we are, it's maybe around 10 a.m. Some people are sleeping, probably it's 2 a.m. and you need help like now. So you need to figure the time zone thing quickly, or you might need to be the one awake during the night because you want help from somebody who will be waking whilst you are sleeping. So you need to figure out how to do about with the time zone thing. Then it requires somebody who can work alone, who can research, who doesn't necessarily need to work. After 20 minutes, they go and ask another developer, how do I solve this? After 20 minutes, they go again. So you need to be able to be independent, work on your own, and then ask for help when necessary. So what do I start with? What do I consider, freelance or remote working or both? What I would recommend is if you are just starting out, being a freelance developer will help you develop skills that you would need when you become a remote developer. So because you train yourself to be independent, work on your projects, manage them, when you become a part of a team which is separated geographically, you are already independent and you can be able to work on those projects and be effective. Then after you have managed to be a good freelancer, you can consider remote working. After remote working, maybe you can do a bit of both. You are employed by a certain company. After you do that, you can do your freelance projects, because remember, you are within your community, so you can be meet your deadlines with your employer and then manage to do some other side projects without affecting anyone. So that is all I had for you this morning. If there are any questions.
Thank you so much, Anna. I think you all agree with me. That was a well put up presentation. Questions? Well, I have one. How best can I really market myself to be a freelancer developer? Let's say I've done a couple of websites and I want to be a freelancer developer who develop websites. How best can I do that?
Okay, you already have projects, so you are already a programmer working. So what you would need to do is, if you are not on LinkedIn, you need to create a profile that you will put all your personal details. You also need to put your qualifications, your work experience, including everything else that you have done before. Then you also put what you have been working on. You list your projects on LinkedIn. You need to create a GitHub account, but I assume you already have one because you said you have some projects. If you don't have one, you create a GitHub account. You also need to create a Stack Overflow account. You might not answer questions, just have it. Then when after you have all that, all those accounts, you now start visiting the websites that are listed. Depending on what you, the locations or whatever, where you want to get your projects. But you already have your CV ready, you have your projects listed, and then when you go to, say, hired.com, they'll ask for all that information. You are supposed to upload your CV or pull it from LinkedIn, so they can do that for you. They'll ask for, again, GitHub account, Stack Overflow. They'll ask for, what's the other one? Sorry. The LinkedIn profile, I've already said that. Then they'll ask for your personal website. So you are doing personal, you are doing websites for other people. You also need to have your own. So after having all that, you can visit, you can create profiles on many websites. I have one on djangojobs.net. I have one I just created recently on hired.com. I'm working on creating one on tunga.com. I have finished creating a profile on OfferZen. So after you have all your projects listed, your resume, they like, you need to register on websites. That will enable you to get opportunities from outside your region. Then you already have projects that you can show off to your customers. So if you know people, probably marketing, especially, it's easier if you do with someone, if you start working with somebody you know. So if you can tell people, I don't know if you go to church or if you go to your club, so wherever you go, that's where you know people. So you can just, whilst you are having your drinks, you can tell them, I develop websites, I have a couple of projects that I can show you. Then you give them a business card. You book a meeting and you go and show them. If you meet them at church, after church, people greet each other. They ask about home and work. What are you doing these days? You know, I'm a freelancer. I do web development. And they'll say, oh, I need help with my website. Come and help me. And then you get jobs like that. So you start with people you know, and if you do a good job, they'll actually refer you to other people they know. So one thing that I've realized is, depending on where you go to church, my church has got very CEOs, directors, common owners, bigger people. So you impress them, you get business from them. If you go to clubs, it depends where you drink. You might, if your clubs don't have people who are, if their own companies, it might be difficult, or maybe they are starting out like you and cannot afford a website, it might be difficult for you to get a job. But if also drink at those clubs, you might meet executive people who also give you jobs. So online, you get, you extend your horizon. Then, where you live, people's skills can help you get jobs. So talk to people.
Any more questions? Anna overlapped a time, so.
Can you please describe your experience as a freelance programmer in the Zimbabwean context, not necessarily outside?
Okay. As a freelance.
What do you think of it? The state right now.
Right now. I think it can work, but it depends on how hard you are prepared to work. So if you can be able to have people's skills and you need to have something to show, be able to book meetings and insist on meeting someone, you can get opportunities and do for them. But also you need to be able to decide on your pricing. If you are doing a website for somebody like me who doesn't have much money, you need to decide whether you are going to entertain those. They can help you just to survive. You charge them low prices. If you are working with companies, you can be able to charge them a lot of money. But you need also to be able to look at a website and tell them your website doesn't work, I can improve it. Because they might have a website which they are not happy with. And then if you criticize it, they can actually do an app. We can ask you to redo the whole thing. So if they have a website, look at how you can improve it, and then they'll give you a job. If they don't, then tell them, how are you operating in this age without a website? And you get jobs.
Cool. I think that would be my last question.
Thank you. What kind of jobs have you done as a freelancer in Zimbabwe?
So far, what I've done is I have actually had to use PHP and WordPress, because the clients I had, they already had a website running on PHP and subscribed hosting for PHP. So with Python, to recommend them to move hosting, it was a bit of a challenge, so I had to redo it using WordPress. But I'm also working on a couple of projects of mine using Python and Django, which I want to develop sort of a CRM system, which I'm working on. So it's a work in progress. It's not yet complete, but when I have projects, I do it. Then I've also done my personal blog using Python and Django. Then I've done my company website also using Python and Django.
Because of time, I won't take any more questions. Next will be Mike.
Thank you.